When I sit back and actually observe the mainstream media in this country, it's almost as if the mainstream media actually works against the people of this country. They always say the things that we don't agree with. You look at that issue of that Nigerian girl, the mainstream media were the ones actually peddling the lies and saying that South Africans are xenophobic, these people are afrophobic. They always call South Africans xenophobic, even though when the people on the ground are simply expressing their frustrations about what the illegals are doing in their own communities. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Weekly News Recap. This is the first episode, and these are kind of episodes that I'm going to do with Mr. Kuobas Kutse. Mr. Kuobas, how are you?
Excellent, Thomas. Nice speaking to you again, and thank you for the opportunity to be on the 360 experience. And I'm very proud of what you are doing and what you're dissecting in the political arena. And yes, I'm excited to be in your hands today.
Yeah, a lot has actually happened. You know that we're going to do these episodes. I think we're going to do them on Fridays. And I want us to look at what happened during this week. But I want us to start about what everyone is talking about. Floyd Shivambu leaving the EFF. What do you think this is going to do to the EFF?
You know, they, originally when I heard the rumor of him leaving, I was like, what? And I mean, I saw Floyd is actually the real political African person behind the EFF. And then there's this clown that jumps up on stages, you know, and he's the guy that plans things that are on the ground with the people. So to me, it was a bit of a shock. But then politics play every week and every day differently. I did not see this coming, I have to admit. I thought these are twin brothers, you know, and you cannot see them apart. But yeah, it was. There's lots of things we can talk about that.
Yeah, because even Julius Malema looked shocked. You remember that press conference when Floyd Shivambu was leaving the party? Even Julius Malema himself, he looked shocked. I said it yesterday that I hoped that Julius Malema would not collapse on stage because the man was near collapsing with shock.
Yeah, you 100% right. I mean, I thought to myself, and I'll be honest with you, I don't know how to be a dictator. But to be a dictator so pathetic on that press conference, I mean, this was ridiculous. I thought, what's wrong with him? As you say, he's going to die now, any moment. Let's get the medical teams in and come and help him. It was actually pathetic from him to do that.
Yeah, but how do you think Julius Malema should actually move forward? Because this is a huge blow to the EFF. And the leadership of the EFF, they have to do something so that the organization can keep going. If you were to advise Julius Malema, what kind of advice would you actually give to Julius Malema?
Well, he came out guns blazing, like we know Julius Malema, after that, because I wouldn't have given Floyd Shivambu the opportunity to have a press conference. I will not help him. He's made his decision. He's leaving it. He's told. I mean, you must just remember what we must. What I just wanted to remind your viewers is that he wrote a WhatsApp to Julius and said, "Listen, I'm not going to renew my membership." As simple as that. I mean, as blood brothers and twin brothers, you don't do things like that. So there must have been a fallout beforehand, and then later that day. But I'm telling you now, Floyd planned this. This is not something, and my feeling is it was actually Zuma who planned this thing. But we'll get into that conversation later. Julius must just go back to his people and tell him. In fact, he's got a bit of a problem because he in his press conference he said Nlozi, if he wants to go, he must go. Nlozi is now saying no, I'm not going. But it was his wife which gave thumbs up to Floyd when he joined the MK, so he was very cross about that as well. And also, Dali Mpofu now, all of a sudden, say, no, I'm staying with the EFF and things like that. But I don't trust these things, the Carl Nias, the Dalia Mpofu. I mean, Dalia Mpofu is in Zuma's conversation every single day. They must drink coffee together, speak to each other. And you cannot speak law things all the time. You must say, you know, Thomas, how's your family? How's your political party? You must at least ask that. So, yeah, he's got to get forces. He's doing the thing like a dictator does. He grabs and say, I'm taking all the deputy president's things immediately under me, and I'm not allowing anybody to touch these kind of things. So, yeah, I think we're going to see how it's going to play out for a little bit. I think he's in trouble. I have to admit, yeah. I think he's in trouble.
Because me, when I saw that press conference, I saw it as I don't know how to put it. Julius Malema did not want to be the face of Floyd Shivambu leaving the party. I saw it as something that Julius Malema did to say, Floyd Shivambu, if you want to leave the party, go out and tell the people that you want to leave the party, because you know how people were going to say it. Yeah. If we just heard on the news that Floyd Shivambu left the party and Floyd Shivambu was not even given a chance to say anything about leaving the party. So I saw that as Julius Malema actually saying that if you want to leave the party, go out and tell these people that you are no longer going to be their deputy president. I'm not going to be the face of you leaving the party, because it was going to be a huge blow if that press conference didn't actually happen, because people were going to say, Julius Malema, you chased out Floyd Shivambu. But people through that press conference, they actually got to understand that Floyd Shivambu is the one that pushed himself out. So Julius Malema is quite clean. And I would actually argue, as much as many people are saying that Julius Malema is going to hurt and is going to destroy him, I can actually argue that this is going to make Julius Malema strong. I can argue that it's going to make Malema strong, because people on the ground, they are feeling sorry for him. I saw even on the comment sections, people were saying that, no, even if I am not a fan of the EFF, but I'm not happy about what Floyd Shivambu did to Julius Malema. So I think when it comes to the core base of the EFF, that is going to give Julius Malema a lot of support. I don't know. Maybe I could be wrong.
No, I think you are 100% as well. But I think at this stage, it's damage control. Yeah. I think that's where the EFF is standing as we speak. He has got a very strong supporters. I mean, we know that. Although he didn't do bad in the national elections, it wasn't that he dropped by 50% or something, but he's got lots of young people. Now, that's another problem. He's not a young man anymore, but sometimes he acts like a young man. But I do think it's basically damage control now, getting his mobilization of the people on the ground, getting his wards and VDs on the ground, because that is the most important thing. You got to get the voice from the people. They want you to stand up now. We've heard you. I know you cried about the situation, but we also cried and we didn't like it. Let's go forward and let's go fight like we've always done.
Yeah. So what do you think this actually says about Floyd Shivambu's character? Because in all of this, man, you know one thing that I was judging? I was looking at Floyd Shivambu's character. And I think this actually says a lot about Floyd Shivambu's character. Because you remember even during that press conference where Julius Malema was fired up, he said that Floyd Shivambu, I tried to talk to Floyd Shivambu and I said, Floyd, what did I do to you so that I can avoid doing this to another comrade? What did I do to you? And Floyd Shivambu said, you did nothing. And we got to learn after that via the MK spokesperson that Floyd Shivambu was actually having conversations with MK party way before the elections. And Floyd Shivambu is the same person that was actually deployed to KZN to mobilize for the EFF. So do you see how Julius Malema sees this thing? That we deployed you to KZN to mobilize for the EFF, and while you were there, you were having conversations with MK party, and EFF performed badly in the same province that you were supposed to mobilize. And now you are joining the political party that actually destroyed us in KZN. And this is how the EFF supporters are actually seeing this thing. And now this is the reason why I think they are coming out to say, Floyd Shivambu, you are a sellout.
Yeah, Thomas, I agree with you fully on that one. But I can just tell you now, I still believe that Zuma is behind this whole thing. You know, as much as I see Floyd as a figurative people for an African representative and his political view on certain things, he's actually a strong person, but he needs guidance. And he was under other people in the organization. He's a person on the ground, not necessarily that person that should speak out loud. And now he's got Zuma. What made his change is that Zuma must have paid him money or convinced him in some way to come to the MK party. Because he has got a very solid political party where he's a deputy leader. He can become the leader. You know, that to me was not the Floyd Shivambu that I've seen on television and on anything else with the EFF.
Yeah, as much as we can say that Zuma is behind it, because obviously he is behind it. He is behind it because Floyd is going to join his political party. But I think Floyd Shivambu, as an individual, as a man himself, he has to be held accountable for his actions and for his decisions. And right. how do you think this is going to work out in the long run for him? We know that right now he has been deployed as a national organizer in Umkhonto weSizwe. We saw the press conference yesterday. How do you think this is going to work out for Floyd Shivambu in the long run?
I saw something the same as what you saw in that press conference. He was sitting with his cap over his eyes, you know. Yeah. He didn't want to face the people, you know. He came in like a naughty little boy that stole some sweets or cake from his grandmother, and he knows he's going to get a mood of hiding now. So that is how I saw him. He wasn't strong. He was sitting there. Later on, Zuma picked him up and said, "This is my man." He was work that I could see that he was a good guy in the ANC Youth League. And now he's a person that are honest. I mean, that's another word. Those words shouldn't be during the MK people there. But, you know, I was looking at, they were announcing this high command. You know, the president, the deputy president, the secretary general, deputy secretary, the treasurer general, the national chairman, the deputy national chairman, and then national organizer. It was like to be a lot afterthought. Oh, what the hell are we going to do? We got him to come to MK now, but what are we going to do with him? We saw that as well. He was carrying in tables and things like that. So if he's good to carry tables, then that's what Zuma wants him to do, then he can do that. I think he made the biggest ever mistake of his political career. He should have taken a sabbatical from it and say, "Listen, Julius, let me just walk away from this for a while. We've been very busy. Let's just relax. You just give me an opportunity to go and relax."
Yeah, and I was saying that. Yeah, I remember yesterday I was having a conversation with my friend, and this is exactly what I said. I said, "Man, maybe Floyd Shivambu should have just said, okay, let me just go on a leave 2 or 3 months so that I can clear my head. Let me just go. I will come back in January, or I will come back somewhere, like sometime, but let me just step away from the EFF issues. Let me just step away from the politics so that I can think and make decisions about what I actually want." Because you saw his body language yesterday. His body language actually said a lot. It is a pity that we don't have a body language expert. I'm sure they were going to tell us a lot.
We don't have to be experts, Thomas. You summed it up perfectly. That's exactly what the people saw there.
Yeah, because it's almost as if he didn't want to look at the public. His cap was in his eyes, and he was just sitting down and looking at his phone. Yeah. He was not like standing up and sitting up as a proud MK member. And I think that actually said a lot. I think this is exactly what even Jacob Zuma saw. This is the reason why he had to pet him and make him stand up and face the cameras and face the people. But like I said, man, where do you think, or how do you think this is going to work out for Floyd Shivambu in the long run?
I think he's going to be on the ground to mobilize people. And the only people that he knows is not going to, well, he has to go to, you know, Floyd is not a Zulu person, so he shouldn't be in Natal. So he's got to be somewhere else, if I'm wrong. He's not a Zulu. So he's got to go to the other provinces. And who are the people that you're going to contact in other provinces? You're going to look for your provincial people and everybody that you had under the EFF and say, hey, guys, I've got a new T-shirt. It's going to be better for us now, you know. Yeah. I don't know how he's going to sell that to the community and how are they going to see this at the end of the day. I think he made a big mistake still. I really believe that.
Do you think the MK guys, especially Jacob Zuma, is gonna look at Floyd Shivambu and he's gonna keep a close eye to him? Because I think what Floyd Shivambu did to the EFF is actually gonna make people to monitor him. Because if you can turn on your brother like that, I think even when you get to MK, I'm sure Zuma is not stupid. I'm sure he's gonna keep a close eye to him.
Yeah, Thomas, you're 100% right. He's going to keep a close eye, but I just think that Floyd is to me, something is wrong there. I think he's probably too tired or too thin, and I think maybe this VBS case is so emotional on him and his family and everything, and, you know, his family might say, listen, it's because of the EFF that you are in trouble today and you are implicated in this VBS scandal, you know, told you not to do that. Then he said, okay, the closest I can get is to, he's like a young implicated criminal with another group. The other guys are all already implicated as well with billions and billions of rands in state capture and impeachment processes. And he's coming in with only I think 18 million rand VBS issue, you know. So he's like a junior boy in the criminal group, if I may call it that way. Yeah, it's going to take a lot from him to stand up and say, now it's MK to the people on the street.
It's going to take a lot, man. And another story, Kobas, man. The one question that I need to ask you, are we being invaded in the country?
Sorry, repeat for me.
Are we being invaded in the country? Because you remember a couple of weeks ago, there's a military site that was actually found in White River. And the initial reports, they said that military base, it looks like it was there for 3 or 4 months. But if you remember that interview that lady did, the South African Police Service whistleblower, she did mention this thing, and it was back in 2021. So the news channels, they try to make us think that this thing was only there for like 4 months, but we got to learn from that lady, the whistleblower, that no, I was having conversations with the higher ups in this country from 2021 about the same things that we are talking about today. So are we being invaded, and what do you think is actually the cause of all of these things?
Thomas, I fully agree that this, the fact that there are all these military base sites, because they're not a security, let's just be honest with each other. It's not a police, a security training camp. The security training camp doesn't have all these military style weapons and also climbing under things, and that, you know, these are warfare type of training that is happening there. Now, I don't clearly think that this is affecting South Africa in a way. I'm going to tell you two things, because these people are people that has been in the military side and they are training people. But what they are doing wrong is that these people come from a country which is under war. And now we're training them in South Africa, and that makes us complicit in training military people against the government, you know. So that to me is a serious thing. There are many, many type of camps and things like that. The infiltration of those people came in under security training, you know, it went through the embassy or the mission there. So all those things was approved, you know, for them to come to do this training. But the people in that community there in Witrifield are under severe attack of these people. There's some rape cases, there's some break-ins and things like that of that 95 in there. So yes, we are bringing in criminals, so-called, to do these kind of things, but we should stop that. So yeah, we got porous borders. That's the bottom line of everything.
Because me looking at this thing, and like, I just can't put my finger to it, man. The fact that we have a military base that was actually found, but the true question is how many military bases and illegal military bases do we have in the country? How many of them do we have in the country, and how many communities are actually suffering, like that community that we spoke about? We only learned about what's happening in that community when this military base was actually found. So you can just sit back and ask yourself how many communities are being terrorized by the same people that are draining in their backyards, man. Like, there is something here.
Well, the thing is that I have to tell you, Thomas, is that there's so many illegal people in our country. And I mean, we have to stop that. We have to stop this illegal immigrants. Every aspect, you know, of our society has been damaged by all these illegal things, taking over our people's shops, the spaza shops, taking over businesses, taking over their houses, and the criminality around these kind of things, you know. So it's got to stop on a thing. And we don't have proper intelligence anymore, because that was broken during the Zuma era. Police security and intelligence, and also military intelligence. So they don't have that. I'm sure Zuma is sitting somewhere from East in Kandla with all these people that he's a phone call. What's happening? What does that guy say? What are, you know? So he's got all his intelligence, and he'll remind people that he's got intelligence all the time. You know. Yeah. So yeah, it's sad. It's sad story, because at the end of the day, it's still these poor people of South Africa that are suffering the most. We can say what we will. The poor people are suffering because of that.
So I look at everything that is happening. When you speak about the illegal immigrants, do you think that there is a political will to actually deal with this thing of open borders? And if there is no political will to deal with the open borders, what is it exactly are these people trying to achieve?
I think that you're 100% right. It's a political will. If you don't have a political will to fix things in South Africa, then you can't do anything. Thomas, yes, the situation is as follows. It's Minister McPherson. He's from the Democratic Alliance. He's now the Minister of Home Affairs. I think it's him.
It's Leon Schreiber.
Schreiber. He's actually now getting behind everything. I mean, from a Miss South Africa case to illegal people that they. So I do believe that the people are definitely starting to open up these can of worms in every single department. Now, even you can see there from the Freedom Front Plus, what's his name from Freedom Front Plus at the Correctional Service?
Groenewald.
I mean, he's also bringing it. Gaiter McKenzie are changing things. Every day you can see he's busy with things and doing the right thing. Now, we could have done this thing right for 30 years already. Now we're 30 years behind. And I'm not 100% sure if the other departments, because it's a cluster of things that's this infiltration that happened. It's police, it's military, it's all these kind of things. The hospitals, our medical people are coming in for having a baby because they can't have it in Zimbabwe anymore. There's just no more hospitals that's working and things like that. So yeah, it's a mess. And I really honestly pray that these things can be rectified, even in my life still, Thomas. I really believe we've neglected the people at the end of the day that are really suffering at the end of the day is the poor people. They've been neglected prior to the 1995. And after the democracy, even worse, they've further neglected. And these things must be fixed, even if it's a small thing. Like I was thinking, you know, I'm in Gauteng. We can have a team on a national level, make it a decision. Let's go to Olivan, let's go to Atlasville, let's go to Mamelodi, let's go to Sushangui. In the next 3 months, we're fixing up everything in that community. The hospitals, the schools, the streets, the water, the lights, electricity, everything, and criminals. That's what I would have done if I was at national level.
Yeah. So what is it exactly where they're trying to accomplish? Because this is one thing that I think South Africans are struggling to understand, that how can you actually allow the borders to be so porous? Because I think one thing that we know is that many of the companies are actually using the illegal immigrants for cheap labor. We know of that, fine. But what is the purpose to actually open up the country so that the country can be completely vulnerable? What is it exactly where these people trying to accomplish by actually getting rid of these borders? I remember the interview that Moeletsi Mbeki did with ENCA a couple of years ago. He was speaking about this, man, and he said that one of the worst mistakes that the ANC did was to make was to allow the borders to be completely destroyed. So what is it exactly? Because there has to be something that someone was trying to accomplish by actually allowing the borders to be so porous.
Thomas, yes. That to me, I've thought about that for many times already. But I can just tell you one thing. Everything wasn't porous borders up till Jacob Zuma era started. Because Jacob Zuma thrives on chaos. The more chaos, the more murders, the more criminality, the more thing, he is happy as a king. And that is the thing that happened. So now you're going into your forces, he's appointing new cadres into the police force, which know nothing about the force. He goes into the military, he goes into all this security cluster. He changed his people that report to him in Nkandla, or that time in parliament. And these guys are doing whatever, and he says, no, let go, you know, don't worry too much about it. And that is the chaos that he creates. We saw that July unrest there of the people going there. It's orchestrated out of his way of doing things. He's a very, very dangerous person while he was still the president of the thing. That should have never happened. That's something in history that should have been wiped out. Okay, there's a lot of things in history that should have been wiped out. But this is so serious. Zuma did so much damage to this country, and it's still ongoing. I mean, we can see Batowi, you know, she's still fighting that battle with that infiltration into the National Prosecuting Authority, which is a major problem for taking cases forward, you know. Right. So, yeah, I do believe that we've damaged our country tremendously in that respect.
Yeah, and another thing, speaking of the police, I saw the police minister, Senzo Mkunu, he was actually defending the KZN police commissioner, Mkwenazi, because you know that for some reason the media in the country has decided to attack Mkwenazi because he's dropping criminals like flies in KZN. And now they are starting to talk about overkill, or are they doing too much? And I saw that Minister Mkunu was actually saying that no, the police cannot run away when they face with the criminals. It's the criminals that are supposed to actually run away. So I couldn't actually understand it. I remember I also did a video about this a week or two ago, where I was actually arguing and saying, why is the mainstream media actually attacking Mkwenazi when Mkwenazi is actually dealing with the criminals decisively? We are talking about the people that are shooting at the police. We are talking about the people that are firing at the police, and the police are firing back, and the police are killing them. But the mainstream media in this country is trying to make people feel or think like the police are totally out of order and they are out to kill anybody. So what actually drove the mainstream media to actually take that position? It is weird. I still cannot understand it.
The mainstream media, for the first time, or let's put it to you this way, I see it for the first time that the police are defending the citizens of South Africa. You must remember now, these criminals are not coming with a pellet gun and a bow and arrow to you. They're coming with AK-47s and massive destruction things to blow up anything. They are highly organized criminals, and you got to fight them in the same way. Otherwise, this is getting out of hand. We also know that in Itakwini and that other area together, there's 18 murders a day. 18 murders a day. Every single day, there's 18 people are going to die. So you can walk in the street and say, listen, guys, you could be one of 18 people today that's going to die. I mean, it's really serious stuff, and you've got to adapt that. I do think it's a political will that came down and said, guys, we now with the GNU, I still laugh about that one, but it's not a government of national unity. It's a grand coalition between the ANC and the DA. What a bad match in any case, but you know, we can have another day story on that. So yeah, they are saying, listen, these DA and Patriotic Alliance and Freedom Front Plus ministers are doing so well, we have to now do something to look good for the people. But they should have taken that stance many years ago, because it's very dangerous.
But why is the mainstream media taking this position? Like, this is one thing that I don't understand. Why is the mainstream media taking this position? Because, when I sit back and actually observe the mainstream media in this country, it's almost as if the mainstream media actually works against the people of this country. They always say the things that we don't agree with. You look at that issue of that Nigerian girl, the mainstream media were the ones actually peddling the lies and saying that South Africans are xenophobic, these people are afrophobic. They always call South Africans xenophobic, even though when the people on the ground are simply expressing their frustrations about what the illegals are doing in their own communities, the mainstream media will go there and say that, no, you people must shut up and you people are xenophobic. Right now, you have the police unit, at least somewhere in the country in KZN, is dealing with criminals. And now the mainstream media is saying, no, the police is doing overkill. So when you look at the mainstream media, these people are always against the people. So it is quite fascinating to see these people always taking the position that is against the people.
Yeah, I don't know how it works, but that's my sense of the media as well. But you'll still have the one or two people that will come back and say, I have got evidence of this. This is what happened. This is the detail. But you know, if you sit in an office as a media person and you're not on the streets in Natal, how can you be objective of what's happening there? Have you been in one of those cars? Have you been in one of those cars when they're chasing these guys of a heist or a bank robbery or a killing or something? I mean, this is not a movie. This is real life. So, yeah, they got it all wrong. I agree with you. And they should rather be more thanking the police to do certain things to keep us safe than the other way around. We also have too many human rights activists in South Africa. I mean, the moment we tell the people that their buildings are with illegal immigrants in the center of Durban, Joburg, Pretoria, and these people are women that are used for sex and drug and everything like that, and children living in these conditions, and then they want to clean out that building. Then these human rights activists jump up and say, no, these are people, you can't evict them, and you know, it's not right.
And the media will give them the airtime to actually go on TV to insult the South Africans. This is the reason why I say, like, it's almost as if these people are so adamant to work against the people of this country. They don't want to hear anything about the people of this country. And now they are heard when they see people gravitating from the mainstream media to YouTube. People are looking at YouTube, people are looking at X to actually find the news. The mainstream media now is feeling sad because people no longer trust them. But it's almost as if they cannot just wake up and realize that, guys, why are we always taking the positions that are always against the people? How can you go against Mkhwanazi when Mkhwanazi is killing the criminals that are killing people? You heard like a couple of days ago, Mkhwanazi was also going against a criminal group that killed six people in one day in KZN. Six people in one day in KZN. But tomorrow, when the news come out that those people have been killed by police, the mainstream media and the police analysts, they will be on TV saying, "Nah, this is overkill. The police and that we need commissions and all of these things." And it is so weird to me. I don't want to lie. Like it is something that I honestly do not understand. Yeah. I also look at the mainstream media in the UK. I look at what's happening in the UK, the riots there in the mainstream media. I look in the United States. I look in the mainstream media in the United States. And there's one common factor about all of these people. They are always taking the position that is against the people. I don't understand.
it is mind-boggling, as they say in English, Thomas, that these people are taking that stance. We have to. Even in South Africa, we're talking only about South Africa, but we cannot defend ourselves anymore. No. Well, you know, there's old age homes and people in retirement or people staying in the villages and they can't defend themselves. I mean, the criminals, I mean, it's happening everywhere and it must stop. It must stop. And yeah. I say the police must do their job. You see, for the first time, they're doing their job of bringing these criminals to account, where they've never done it because they were not allowed to do it. They were summoned to the police minister's office. Why did you guys shoot on these people? We're going to lose votes. You know, that type of nonsense. You know, yeah. So I agree with you. The media is wrong in this. Yeah.
So one, again, Kobas, one of the stories that actually caught my attention during this week, it was a story of what actually is happening in the Eastern Cape. I'm going to read two paragraphs from this article that was actually released by the SABC. It says that Deputy Defense Minister Bantu Holomisa says he has met with the Police Minister Senzo Mqunu and the Eastern Cape Premier Oscar Mabuyane to discuss the escalation of the extortion in the province. It is alleged that the extortion syndicates in the Eastern Cape are demanding protection fees from businesses, schools, and healthcare facilities. Mabuyane told the ministers in the security cluster that the situation was getting out of hand, particularly on the Wind Coast, which has major construction projects. Holomisa says the calls for the deployment of the South African National Defence Force are premature, but should be there if there's a need. The Premier is of the view that the military must get involved. Yesterday, the police minister released a statement to the effect that they are deploying detectives and police in the Eastern Cape. He says that we are hoping that after they have satisfied themselves and gathered enough intelligence, they can approach the president. What do you think it's like? What's happening there in the Eastern Cape?
Thomas, it's happening everywhere. It's happening in Gauteng. It's happening in KwaZulu-Natal. It's happening in the Eastern Cape. I didn't read that article, but yes, I read the article which they were speaking to Bato Olumisa, where he basically said that there is and the problem rise there at Mata, and it was because of a medical practice that was closing down, another business, another community service, another thing that our people in the community needs has closed down and said, "I can't take this anymore." It's happening in the Western Cape as well. Restaurants, they've been extortion all over. That is another thing that should take action, because these guys are really threatening. They go to you, they know who your family is, they know who your friends is, they know where you stay, which school your children go to, what you do on a Friday night and a Saturday morning and every day. And they will probably take, they have taken some people out already to say, be careful, don't don't, you've got to pay. So they are collecting money all the time. So yes, it's still a political will thing. Are we going to fix this? Yes. Send in the defense force, Batu and Lumisa say no, we mustn't, because they don't have intelligence and they're just going to murder the people. That was his words. So I thought, yeah, you know, it makes sense to me. Or maybe we should all go in there and go and murder the people that are extorting and vandalizing and or threatening our community businesses and construction sites.
Yeah, because if you read about these things, like you say, that this is something that is happening all over the place. I remember a couple of days ago, I was watching a documentary about Khayelitsha and some of these gangs in Khayelitsha that were actually priding themselves to extorting the businesses. So I know what you're talking about when you say that this is something that is actually happening everywhere in the country. Do you think that this is one of the problems that was actually ignored under the ANC?
You know, Thomas, the reason why I'm laughing is that everything was ignored. There's a long list of things in our country that has been ignored. I mean, where you stay and where I say, we can be another half an hour telling you what's wrong in our communities. I mean, let's be honest with you. But where do we start? I think the biggest one for me is safety. If we can create a society that are safe, that our children can play in the streets, we can go to the shop. You don't have to have all the security fences, burglar bars. You know, people must just be able to, you're scared that your children is on their way from the bus, not going to get home or to the bus, you know. So I'm just saying that if I could sort out crime today, that will be my priority, is to let people stay safe. Safety, make sure that the police are on the ground, you know. I would start off with, you know, apart from the gas explosion that they had next to the police training facility in Pretoria, but sorry, it's another day story. I don't know what happened there, you know. I would really bring in let's make it not a compulsory, but a voluntary year that people can go from the age of 16 or 17, go to a military school. I wouldn't call it now a military, then we're now in White River again. Go to a school where people can be taught some discipline, and they must come all over South Africa there. Community safety, I must call it community safety. They get training for a year. Then they go back to the community that they have been trained for. And that is their police service career. And they are appointed in there. They know the people, they know the streets, and they know how to do their jobs. That is what one of the suggestions that I would have for the police to combat this crime that is really failing our people in South Africa.
So if you were, Senzo Mkunu, dealing with these things, specifically of the extortions, where would you actually start?
I will start by firing all my generals there. Mm. And I'll appoint people that has got the qualifications, proper qualifications, that hasn't been coming through the ranks as a cadre deployment. I'll get an investigative team, the people that shouldn't be there, etc. And then, you know, when we did years ago, I did the 2-year military service, you know, it was all in the apartheid era. When you are a bit bulky, you know, you can't run. And when I look at the police or the metro police, you know, in town, I said, how ish, they can't run. Any criminal can run away from them, you know. So we got to look at that training as well, because you have to train every day, fitness and things like that. People sit in the police offices, and when the person comes and say, listen, my daughter has just been raped, okay, fill in this form, you know, sit there, take the thing. Oh no, we're not gonna file this. This is not real stuff. You haven't got the person's name and his surname and his fingerprints attached to your affidavit, you know. It's so stupid. They're not helping the community. You know, I grew up in a town on the East Rand in and you know, the people that were respected in our community was all the ministers and pastors, and really they were the respected people there. The town treasurer, I mean, people knew who he was here because he's looking after the people. He's building more churches and clinics and all this kind of thing. The actual head of the fire department, he was a respected person. The police officers were respected. And we as Afrikaans people, ons was kak bang vir hulle gewees hoor. I'm telling you that we were so scared. They had a I don't know what the English word is, Thomas, I must tell you this quickly. They had a person they called a lammer vanger. Now, a lammer is a small sheep. You know, it's a small sheep. Now, these lammer vangers were not wearing police clothes, ordinary clothes. If you're not at school, they take you to your house to find out if your parents are there. They warn your parents and then they take you to the school and they take you to the headmaster of the school. So if you wanted to duck and dive, you would have... That day you're not going to go to school. Those lammer vangers were all over the place and they would take you back to school. And those were the discipline that we must bring back to our people. And let me tell you, our people wants that.
Yeah. So even me personally, I think like this just shows the gross incompetence of the intelligence, man. These people are heavy, like they are talking on WhatsApp. Like the intelligence should be able to pick that up, that okay, these people are actually conspiring and these people are actually talking about committing crimes. Like when such things actually happen, it actually shows us how poor our intelligence is. You think about the military bases, you think about these guys that are selling the drugs in the communities, you think about the extortionists, and they are having conversations that should be picked up over the intelligence, but it looks like these people are not able to pick up anything. It looks like we are in a lot of trouble, Kobus.
You're 100% right. It is something that bothers me for many, many years, is that we were aware of the national intelligence that was broken by during the Zuma era. We know about the military intelligence that was broken during that era. But we don't have that kind of intelligence from police, where they are planning things, because everything that the police are doing today is reactive. Nobody does something proactive. And if we don't get to do something proactive in our communities, we're not going to be able to fix things. But it is a political will, but people, it has changed so much of the real policemen. And I believe there are still very, very good policemen out there that really want to make a difference in our communities, but their lives are in danger, and that can only be fixed from a straight way of saying, now we are taking all these criminals. And that brings us back to our discussions that we had from the mainstream media, which says, no, you don't do that. I agree with you. We should show the criminals. They are showing us what they've been doing, raping and killing and things like that now, and burglaries. Now let the police show that, it be a warning to them, and that is the point that I'm making.
Yeah. So do you think that there's going to be a couple of politicians that are going to be exposed with this thing of the extortions? Do you think that there are politicians behind it?
There must be politicians behind it, because everything that happened during the political era from Zuma entered up till now has had a political connection. So I have got no doubt that I don't know how they're going to be exposed, you know, but there are certain money that they get, and they probably receive a parcel at Letuli House or something, I don't know. But Thomas, yeah, because if they don't get something, then they would have had a political will to fix the problem.
Yeah.
Now that they don't do something about it, I believe that they are getting a backhand or something.
Yeah. So now there's a story that people are actually not paying attention to. Zuma has actually missed an appeal deadline. You remember that the ANC expelled him and they gave him 21 days to actually appeal, but it looks like Jacob Zuma did not appeal. What do you think this actually means for Jacob Zuma and the ANC, and where do you think this matter is going?
Thomas, the bottom line that I can tell you, if you are in any political party, and tomorrow I'm in Thomas, I'm in your political party, and the Mabasu K party, you know, MK party, we have our own MK party, and I come to you and I don't come to you, I start my own political party, CC party. Why do I have to go through a disciplinary hearing? Why do I have to go through that? I'll fire you just there and then. You have insulted the political party. Go. I nearly said a bad word. No. He's also have, apart from that, 10 of those 18 people that they pushed out the parliament to make place for Floyd Shivambu and Key, Brian Mulefe, Siyabongwe Gama, who's the other from Praza, Lucky Montana. So yeah. these guys are going to parliament now. But those guys that they kicked out is now saying, listen, we are still MK members. We're going to court. They have gone to court, but he's already missed a deadline to reply to their founding affidavits. So he's slipping on. I think he just doesn't care. But by law, you have to go from your party list registered at the electoral commission. So he cannot just fly in and fly out people all the time. They must be on the list. His daughter is implicated because she forged the signature of the founder member, a founder of MK, what's his name? Any case, the guy that originally, which also taking Zuma to court now, she forged the signature to take him off as a director, and then she could make the changes and things like that. She also took his email address from MK off, and she typed letters to the IEC as if it was him. Yeah. So, but you know, when you got a daddy that plans criminality every day, you know, it runs in the family.
So you think Zuma doesn't care about the ANC anymore?
No, he doesn't care about the ANC. I mean, he sucked out his 15%, 10% from the ANC and 5% from the EFF or whatever. So he's unfortunately he's overstaying his welcome, you know.
So should we expect a press conference from Balula to announce that it's official, Zuma is out?
You know, sometimes I think Balula must say nothing, you know. So he's not always on track with what really happens on the ground. But I think there was an announcement from the Veterans League, which they had it on mainline that he has been officially expelled. So I think that to go and make a fuss about it is going to give Zuma more airtime.
I think
that was said that we're not going to give Zuma any more airtime in from our political view. The same as a lot of people say, you know, Julius hates all the people, the white people. He still lives in the apartheid era and colonialism and all this nonsense, you know, all these conspiracy theories, I call it. And one should just not give him those kind of people, give them airtime at all. You know, the mainline media should actually do the people a favor and say, look, we're not going to go to that event today. We're not going to be there. Let's let all the international guys that want to go to the event, let them go. But local, SABC, ENCA, you know, all the local people don't go there. News Africa, you know, so let's not support this kind of things. To put a message out, because the media has been criticized by the EFF for many, many things, you know. Well, they've been criticized by the DA as well, and also from the ANC and things. But they're not getting their facts right about situations, you know. And I agree with you, you know, this the media is not playing a proper game for the people of South Africa.
Yeah. So Kuabas, thank you so much, man. We've covered a lot. We will meet again next week, Friday. What would you like to say before I let you go?
Yeah, I've got two things that I've got. You know, Thomas, you know, me and you, when we start talking, we can't stop. But I just wanted to say that, you know, there's a lot of things happening in the metros at the moment as well. You know, we saw that Dharam Murare, he's now the new mayor there.
But he said the people of Joburg must not expect much from him.
Now, I agree. I actually don't want to hear it, but I agree with it. It's a true story. That is a true story that you are saying. But we actually got, Councillor Matembu, which is the caucus leader of them. She's a young woman. I don't think she's over 30. She's actually good looking as well. but she's been the caucus leader for Action SA in the city of Johannesburg since 2021. Well spoken, well qualified. I believe she's an accountant in the corporate world before joining from there she got this position in the caucus. We need a bean counter. If there's one time we need a bean counter in the city of Johannesburg, we need that. And also the other thing that I wanted to mention was Herman Mashaba is basically saying that we have to do something for the people of South Africa. Every day we have to fix things, and we have to, even if we have to work with the ANC, we're not taking any executive position, but we'll hold them accountable. And the speaker's position is very powerful. She's a non-executive member. And all these things that got to be passed by council lands up on her desk, you know? Mm. And she will decide whether that goes to council or not. So it's a very, very powerful position to hear as that. Action SA is also going to, is busy speaking to other metros, Swanee as well. The other thing that I just wanted to also mention to you is that 4,200 carats diamond found in Botswana.
Yeah.
I mean, we don't have to talk anymore. We can just go on holiday and live a luxury. I mean, this lady holds this thing like that. I mean, it's massive. So I want to finish off in saying, you know, I hope everybody on your subscribers are diamonds in your program. And once again, thank you for the opportunity, and nice speaking to you. And I'm looking forward to see what what all the subscribers are going to say about our interview. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that, Thomas.
Yeah, that was it on Weekly News Recap. This is the first episode. Please don't forget to tell us what you think on the comment section. And like, guys, please like the videos. And the most important part, subscribe. My name is Thomas Mabaso and Kuabas Kotsi. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
The 360 Experience with Thomas M.